Let's keep going. Michigan's financial health. Let's look at the debt side of things in terms of government debt and how it's continuing to grow. While we've gone on, these are three different kinds of bonds: general obligation bonds, revenue bonds issued by the state, and revenue bonds issued by public authorities. Look at those bar charts. We've continued to add at an increasing pace the amount of debt in our state. Remember what I just said about how much we had set aside. So we're spending more than we're taking in. We don't have any real reserves. We have no rainy day fund. And we're taking on more debt at these levels. Next slide, please. This is just another way to look at it in terms of in relationship to per capita growth. Per capita income growth is the red line. You can see per capita income change in the state of Michigan in that time period, which goes clear back to 79 or so, has been relatively flat. Look at the debt levels taken on by the state on a per capita basis. I got out of school in 82. I can see we've been using our credit card at the state on a pretty hefty basis over the last few years, over the last two or three decades. The per capita debt from 79 to 2009 has gone from $729 to almost $2,400. And when I say per capita debt, this is the issued debt. This doesn't include those unfunded obligations or other things I'm talking about that are still to come in our discussion today. Next chart. Let's turn to the pension side of things and look at the pension obligations. And these have state and local and school district in them, but I don't believe they have all jurisdictions, but they had the ones that were readily available and that are the bigger state-run programs. And some of the city, I believe Detroit may be in this list. So it has Michigan and Detroit programs. So there are some other programs out there that probably would add to this, but it basically shows you the relationship of obligations for pension, which is the top line, and the value of our pension assets. And that gap that's colored in red basically shows the deficiency in what we have obligated ourselves and which we need to pay, because these people have earned those obligations, and the assets we have available. The gap amounts to a fairly significant number. You can see that. The combined shortfall of just these plans is $18 billion. That's in addition to that per capita debt number I gave you. Now, just sort of sum it all up, let's go to that last slide we have. If you take the debt number and you add in the unfunded obligation number and you add in the medical retirement number, we have about $11 billion, I believe, would be the fund balance number at the state for net assets in some ways. We have obligations of about $55 billion, so we would end up about $43 billion in the hole. This is not all inclusive either, by the way. This is the good data. These people worked really hard, but there is more numbers out there that I can pretty much tell you. Those numbers that we don't have included are not going to improve this answer. So it's a sobering day to say, here's basic information that we should all have available. There are the things that I would include on that list that are still to come that we're working on. One that I will mention that I will talk about on February 17th, this does not include things such as tax credits that we committed to and incentives. That we've gone out and said, here are tax credits for you, that are future tax credits that are refundable in a number of cases that we need to pay out. That adds to this number. This number also, I don't believe, includes the unemployment situation in terms of the numbers out there, that if you, we have another chart in there before the very back of this booklet that says we're about $3 billion in the hole for unemployment insurance because of the high rate of unemployment in our state. So the situation, if you step back for a minute and say, where are we at? We've been spending each year beyond what we take in. To do that, we've issued more debt. We've also gone out and entered into contractual obligations or commitments where we didn't have funding set aside for, or we didn't fund as we went on a continuing basis. In addition, we put out incentives for people to come here that we also didn't fund. And in terms of what we had in our bank account to do this with, we spent that down during the toughest times. So in terms of cash available, cash on hand, we actually go to short-term borrowings to get by in our state already. We have $2.2 million in our rainy day fund or so, and our reserves are low. And they're really not that accessible. I call them reserves, but they're not something you're going to be able to go get anytime soon. Now, one could get depressed. And those of you that know me, I don't get depressed easy. And that's not the point of this exercise. People wondered why I called for this exercise going back almost a year and a half ago. I knew what the numbers were going to look at. Being fortunate enough to be a CPA, I'd read the CAFR. And I knew how this would turn out. But that's one reason I wanted to be governor of the state of Michigan. Because it's not to walk away from a problem. It's now to say, here are the facts. We're going to solve the problem. We're not going to back away from this. I'm proud this is done because now we can have the intelligent, thoughtful discussion we needed to have, and we will put a plan in place to get us on a positive path, to make us a great state again. We won't beat this. We will beat this. We won't let this problem beat us because this is critically important. And it's not just critically important for us. Many of us are very successful and we'll be fine. But this is really important for our kids and our kids' kids. My view is it's time for us to step up, take responsibility for the present financial position we're in, but also say we're going to take responsibility for what our predecessors left us with and not say this is a burden for the future. So I'm here today to say my view is it's not about me, it's about we stepping up to say we're going to do the right thing, we're going to take responsibility, we're all going to have to tighten our belts, and God knows I need to lose a little weight anyway, and we're going to work hard and make this happen. And we're going to do it in a fashion where it is shared sacrifice, and we understand there are people really suffering in our state because of a tough economy, and we're not going to do it simply on their backs. But we need to do this together as a team. And that's the right direction to head. So that's why today is a great day. The information is depressing. The outcome, though, is the right thing. And so that's where I'm excited. And I hope you'll be excited as you go out of here to say, now, we're going to grab this thing and we're going to make it happen. And to help do that, I had one other tool I wanted to share with you. You've seen what these wonderful people, these five different organizations have done with this document. And please go study it and please share it with everyone. It'll be up on the website at michigan.gov. The business leaders will have it up. I'm happy to have the press here today, and hopefully we'll get good coverage on this. But the other thing that we've done is they've created a transparency tool. They've created a tool to allow other jurisdictions to go through the same exercise. And I want to compliment. There are some great jurisdictions out there that, again, they do equivalents of CAFRs. Everyone in the state does in some fashion already. And some do some simple explanations. But to help other jurisdictions that don't have that, is this team, these five groups, have come together to create a transparency tool that Carolyn's going to walk us through that basically says you can do this for your jurisdiction. You can do it for your municipality. You can do it for your school district. And my goal And my request of every jurisdiction, I'm not saying you have to do it, but my request that I view as an extremely prudent, right thing to do is that every jurisdiction do the same thing. And the thing I also ask, since I got the soapbox, I might as well throw it in, I hope you do a dashboard too. Because those are the kind of metrics and measures that will fundamentally keep us on the path to a phrase I do like. Because you do know the way I like to operate. Relentless positive action. We have serious problems. We just covered serious problems. It's not time to cry about it. It's not time to whine about it. It's time to go to work. And with relentless positive action, we'll make this happen. So, thank you.